Swing low, sweet chariot, come in to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, come in to carry me home.
So I'd like to re-welcome everyone. My name is Andy Pochatko. I am a reference librarian up at Harbor Topkey Library in Ashtabula. My hometown is actually here in Conneaut, and for several years I have researched Conneaut history. So with this pilgrimage today, I agreed to do a cemetery tour of sorts. We're here at Conneaut City Cemetery, also known as Liberty Street Cemetery. The cemetery is actually one of the oldest in northern Ohio, the oldest burial here being 1804. In addition to many veterans of the Revolutionary War, War of 1812, Civil War, up through our most current wars, there are many abolitionists buried here. I do want to say I don't have a microphone today, so if at any time you can't hear me, if I'm talking too softly, just raise your hand, let me know. For the purposes of time and such, I ask that questions be withheld until the end or until we're walking, one of the two, just for time's sake, because I know you have a lot to cover today. So. Thou shalt not deliver unto his master the servant who has escaped from his master to you. He shall dwell with you, even among you, in that place which he shall choose in one of thy gates, where he likes best. You shall not oppress him. These words come from Deuteronomy chapter 23, verses 15-16. And they were quoted by Reverend Rufus Clark, who was a minister here in Conneaut. And he took these words as divine command that people should not take up slaves. They should instead work to help free them. What was happening around this time that inspired people such as Rufus Clark was a historical phenomenon called the Second Great Awakening. And basically what's going on here is that you have evangelical religious revivals happening, kind of like these tent camp meetings. And in Ashtabula County, this was especially prevalent among Baptist and Methodist groups. But what ended up happening was that in this religious fervor, they found that they had renewed interest in aiding oppressed slaves in the South. So all through the 1830s, we find 1834, the Ashtabula County Anti-Slavery Society is formed. William Hubbard, whose house you just visited, was one of the founding managers here. In 1835, the Ashtabula County Female Anti-Slavery Society was formed. And there was a famous woman involved with that, Betsy Mix Coles from Austinburg, who not only was an abolitionist, but she was an educator and an early feminist. In 1837, there's also anti-slavery meetings in Ashtabula and Kingsville. Then finally, in 1839, I guess Conneaut was a little bit behind the times, the Conneaut Anti-Slavery Society was formed. The Conneaut Anti-Slavery Society was formed in response to it was called the General Conference of Free Will Baptists. And it was held at the Southridge Free Will Baptist Church. Later on in the tour, you will be visiting, as part of the Harvest Festival, the Southridge Baptist Church, which is the successor to the Free Will Baptist Church. At this convention, they issued a statement against slavery, choosing, as Reverend Clark says, to be right with the few rather than wrong with the many. So at the time, pro-slavery sentiments were still kind of the norm for society, South and North. After the formation of the society, membership swarmed to 150 plus people. So you can tell, around here at least, there was an avid interest in anti-slavery activities. At their meetings, they readily debated slavery, but they also heard many anti-slavery speakers. They'd have escaped slaves come in and tell their stories. What's important about the about noting these anti-slavery societies is that from these abolitionist roots comes the impetus, but also the legend of the Underground Railroad. So when we talk about the Underground Railroad, we talk about something that is often mythologized. Most of what we know, quote unquote, about the Underground Railroad comes down to folklore. So as historians, we have to separate that which is fact and that which is fiction. In reality, few slaves escaped via the Underground Railroad. This is an important point. If they managed to get on one of the routes, they had already traveled a great distance without the aid of anyone else. Most of the slaves escaped on their own volition. They did not escape via the Underground Railroad. But that being said, there were those people who risked fines and imprisonment to aid fugitive slaves because they felt it was their moral obligation. So why did slaves escape? Well, that's a complicated issue. More often than not, we're told that they wanted freedom. Many sought to live their own lives without interference from others. But the reality of it is, too, there were many slaves who were also content to stay on the plantations. We have kind of like the Roots mentality, the Roots miniseries from the 70s, where we have this overarching image of slavery. In reality, there were, you're going to have your bad. You'd have the whippings, the maimings, the malnourishment, inadequate clothing and shelter. And that would increase the reasons for escape. But on the other hand, slaves were also considered an investment to a slave owner. So in many cases, they were taken care of for life. They were fed, had sheltered. But here's the issue with that. Despite the paternalistic feelings and being well taken care of, it was without their consent or without contract. They had absolutely no say whether or not they wanted to be slaves. Another point too, even those so-called paternalistic masters that took care of slaves would die. So with after the death, there'd be rumors of sale or being sent off to different relatives. So that also would lighten the chance of escape. So thus, when opportunity arose, some slaves took it upon themselves to escape to freedom. So those slaves who entered the Underground Railroad entered not into a highly organized national network, but a loosely organized string of connections. And if you're an abolitionist, if you're a station master on the Underground Railroad, you really didn't want to know beyond your township or your county limits. You might have the feds come after you. And that's something that happened to William Hubbard. He was sued in federal court by a Virginia slave owner for aiding slaves. So as I said, many slaves escaped without help from the Underground Railroad. But those who did, you have to remember, if you're trying to escape, you're not going to readily trust someone you just met on the street. You're not going to jeopardize your freedom, just say, oh yeah, I'm going to help you, because there were bounty hunters out for people. So whether or not a slave was traveling with or without an Underground Railroad conductor, concealing oneself from detection was important. There's a famous case of Henry Box Brown, who convinced one of his slaves to actually box him up in a wooden crate and have him shipped north. Of course, once the Southerners heard about that from the abolitionists, they put the kibosh on that real quick. Forging documents was another way to get by. You might also travel with a companion whose complexion was much lighter. And this is a notion that's called passing, where a person with lighter skin, even though you might have some African-American blood in you, could pass. Or I mean, it didn't even have to be that complex. It could just be simply under the cover of darkness. So at this time, that's my brief introduction to the Underground Railroad and abolitionism. So at this time, we're going to begin the cemetery tour part of this journey. And the Lake family was one of the older families of Conneaut. Hiram Lake's father, Henry, actually came to Conneaut before the War of 1812. He came to Conneaut actually to build a furnace, an iron furnace. And he entered into partnership with a gentleman by the name of Solomon Spaulding. Now, if any of you have read in Ashtabula history, there is a controversy in the origins of Mormonism called the Solomon Spaulding controversy. Solomon Spaulding was the purported author of the Mormon Bible, at least in this area. Whether or not there's any truth to that, we have been unable to discern that, but of course the Latter-day Saints vehemently deny that. The furnace actually ended up failing, so I guess you can say that Hiram's father really wasn't much of a business, or yeah, Hiram's father wasn't much of a businessman. But I think really Hiram made up for it, because he became postmaster of Conneaut at one time. He ran a general store. He is also the one responsible for leading the campaign to change the name of the town to Conneaut. Originally, the name of the town was incorporated as Salem. And this stayed until the 1830s, until Hiram convinced the townsfolks to vote in the name of Conneaut, which was the name of the creek and also the post office. Early on, he was a member of the Conneaut Anti-Slavery Society. And in 1845, he actually served as a delegate to the Liberty Party convention. Now, to us, the Liberty Party is doesn't mean anything today, but in reality, it is a precursor to Abraham Lincoln's Republican Party. And what they ended up doing was running on a platform exclusively based on anti-slavery. So. You had a political process going on at the time. Really didn't succeed, but at least it gave impetus to Lincoln's party. Hiram Lake's daughter actually recalled later on in her life that at times when she would come back and visit before the Civil War, that the root cellar was quote unquote filled with slaves. I do believe, Toby, you're still... Okay. Yeah. So you'll be able to see where slaves were hidden for yourself today. Okay. So that's all I have on Hiram. So we can move on to our next. Also at the Liberty Party convention, as I mentioned, Hiram Lake was Marshall Wright. And it's no surprise, really, that Marshall's and Hiram Lake's views were so close together. Just down the road there a little bit, Fanny is actually a relative of Hiram Lake. So you can see the abolitionist families kind of marrying together. During Marshall Wright's long life, he held several prominent positions within Ashtabula County. He was sheriff at one time, he was a county commissioner, a postmaster, justice of the peace. He also was the director of what was called the infirmary back then, now Ashtabula County Nursing Home. During the American Civil War, he was quartermaster for the 155th Ohio Volunteer Infantry. For today, however, we're just going to focus on his accomplishments as an abolitionist. One such story that involves Marshall Wright is the story of a slave named Lewis Clark. Lewis Clark escaped from Kentucky and was pursued by his master to Ashtabula County, where he was recaptured. And being that abolitionism was so hot here, word quickly got back to Joshua Giddings, who was the anti-slavery state representative to the House of Representatives. And what Giddings does, he issues a writ of habeas corpus, basically an arrest warrant for the escaped slave. The only caveat was to this, Lewis Clark, the slave, had to be found within the limits of Ashtabula County. It was only good for the limits of the county. So the sheriff sends out a search team, and eventually they find the master and the escaped slave, and they're traveling along a county line road between Lake County and Ashtabula County. So if the buggy is over in Lake County, the writ is no good. If they're in Ashtabula County, the writ's good. So what did the sheriff do? Put a roadblock in Lake County. So in a sense, the carriage is forced over into Ashtabula County, where Lewis Clark is taken into the custody of the Ashtabula County Sheriff's Department. After he was taken into custody, he was taken to Jefferson, where he was freed and presumably put on a network of the Underground Railroad. And the story that comes down to us from Reverend Rufus Clark, he said that Lewis Clark, no relation, was then taken to M.W. Wright's house in down near Kellogg'sville.
Okay.
Move along to our next stop, which over in that direction.
The real old ones up front, are those the real old tombstones, are those
tinkered? As far as I know, tinkers weren't involved in making of the stones. Carl Feather actually did a newspaper article about that back in the 90s, I believe. But yeah, it's one of those pieces of folklore in Ashtabula County history that, because they're kind of out of the ordinary in in a cemetery that you see the stone monuments. But if anyone can really be called like the doyen or the grandmaster of the Underground Railroad in Conneaut, it would be the Reverend Rufus Clark. Clark actually wrote a history after the American Civil War about the community called South Ridge around the church that you're going to be visiting later on. And it's from him that we have a lot of information about the Underground Railroad, abolitionism, and escaped slaves. That being said, whenever you have a source that was written after the fact, it's always suspect. You have to take it with a grain of salt. That being said, there's some great stories there, so it is what it is. Not only was he a minister for the Free Will Baptists, he was a member of the Conneaut Anti-Slavery Society as well, and he was actually known for his firebrand sermons against slavery. Many of these were published in the Conneaut paper during the 1850s. Reverend Clark tells a story of a man named George Perkins, who was 21 years old at the time of his escape, and he was the son of John Perkins of Louisiana. He was the son of his slave master. Reverend Clark notes that he had what was called American features. Essentially, he was of mixed race. His father took George Perkins to visit a Kentucky senator, and during that time, George took the opportunity to flee. When Reverend Clark interviewed him, it was noted that on George's body there were several scars, and they were inflicted by his father and his father's wife. On his arm there was a scar from where he'd been beaten with a shovel. On his chest, somebody had taken a butcher's knife to him. And on his head, he had been beaten with a sharp stick. Clark notes that Perkins stayed with him for the weekend and then was moved forward on the Underground Railroad. It notes here on the stone that for 50 years, Reverend Clark was a minister. So he had a long career aiding the slaves. At his church, he actively encouraged anti-slavery message. As I said, he did. He wrote the sermons that were published in the paper and such. So really, he inspired an entire community of abolitionism through his preaching. So I think for that, he should be well noted. Oops. What's that? Yeah. Yep. Yeah. If. Yeah. If. Yeah. Yeah. If. Yeah. If you look on the front, I note the back is out here. It has his information on front here, and then in the ground right here there are two footstones. One for Reverend Clark and his wife Celia. At this time, we'll proceed on to our next stop. The stone that we're looking at is the Hayward Stone back here. Before we get to him, I have a little aside to talk about. Unlike the Reverend Rufus Clark, not all abolitionists were tied to one place. Some moved from spot to spot, depending on their vocation. Around this time, before the American Civil War, it was common to have circuit preachers. Essentially, what you'd have was someone who would preach at one church one day and another church the next day. Of course, within either Methodism or Baptist or, in this case, Universalism. One such preacher was a man by the name of Reverend Charles L. Shipman. Shipman was a Universalist preacher from Gustavus, Ohio. That's south of us on Route 7 in Trumbull County. But he would go from church to church. He would start off in Gustavus, move to Andover and south of the county. He'd go over into Pennsylvania, into Crawford County, Linesville. And then he'd cross back over into Ohio and go to Kelloggsville, eventually making his way over into Erie County in Girard, Pennsylvania. In his obituary, it was said that he was said to have known John Brown of Harper's Ferry fame, who also had an Ashtabula County connection. And it's even possible that he may have preached to Abraham Lincoln in Illinois. Of course, there's no actual record of that. That's just one of those nice pieces of folklore that we have no proof on. But someone who may have aided Reverend Shipman in his Underground Railroad activities was Samuel Hayward of Kelloggsville. Hayward was trained as a leather tanner, but eventually got into banking. And at the time of his death in the 1880s, he was actually mayor of Conneaut. We have an account from a book called From Dixie to Canada, Romances and Realities of the Underground Railroad. It's one of those post-Civil War books that talks about different stories of the Underground Railroad, and it's a major source of folklore, that Hayward played an escape in the role of a slave named Edward Howard, who, in his escape, made his way from station to station across Northeast Ohio. Let's think about time for a second here. Most of you drove from Ashtabula to Conneaut in 20 minutes. That's what, a 15, that's a maybe a 15-mile drive. But for someone who is on foot or in a wagon, that could be several hours on foot or in the wagon. So time is definitely a factor we need to consider here. And the fact that he was all over Northeast Ohio before gaining his freedom, I think, is quite noteworthy. So he's all over Northeast Ohio, And despite a couple, several close calls, he eventually makes his way to Samuel Hayward's house before being shipped on to Wesleyville, Pennsylvania, where he is sent over to Canada via boat. Although I said Hayward probably aided Shipman, there is no written record of this. There's only circumstantial evidence for this claim, but I think it's some good evidence. Samuel Hayward's mother was a Universalist. Going to head over towards that sandstone monument, and this will be our last stop for today. I mentioned in the case of the slave that Samuel Hayward helped escape that he was shipped over to Canada on a boat. More often than not, Canada became the final destination for many slaves as they got to the north. Sad fact of it is, many northerners were just as racist as the ones in the south. Basically, what you're operating is on the principle is, well, I'll help you escape, but you're not going to stay here. It's one of those NIMBY principles, not in my backyard. So many of them ended up crossing over into Canada. And you could cross over on foot, either up by Detroit, or the other route would be over towards Buffalo. If you're lucky, however, you could perhaps get a trip on a ship. This was the case of the slave named J.D. Green. Green, according to his narrative, escaped from slavery three times. And it was on his third try that he escaped via the aid of a boat. Now, he didn't make it to Canada on this try, but he was able to escape with the aid of a boat. As fate would have it, his master took him on a boat called the Sultana. The Sultana at the time was captained by Gilman Appleby. As Green himself wrote, I'm going to read an excerpt for you. "I was placed in the cabin, and at dinner, the steamboat started and had about half a mile to go before she got into the lake. And on the way, the captain," this is Captain Appleby, "came down to me and cautiously asked me if I could swim. I answered I could. When he told me to stand close by a window, which he pointed out. He said, and when the paddle wheel ceased, I must jump out." So Captain Appleby told him, "I'm going to stop the motor and you're going to jump out into the lake." Mind you, this was November when this escape happened. "I stood ready, and as soon as the wheel ceased, I made a spring and jumped into the water. And after going a short distance, I looked up and saw the captain standing on the promenade deck, who, when I saw I was clear of the wheels, waved a signal for the engineer to start the vessel." So sort of an interesting tale of not exactly taking him to Canada, but still using a boat to aid his escape. Some of the resources that we read about Conneaut credit Gilman's brother Calvin with being the abolitionist. I haven't been able to find any primary resources to verify this, so I say that with a caveat. Calvin, however, has a more interesting, or he has an equally important part to play. And I use this story as part of my conclusion for presentations. 1860, Abraham Lincoln is elected President of the United States. And with his election, there's a lot of unease among the Southerners because of Lincoln's rumored anti-slavery views. And on his way to Washington, Lincoln makes his way from Springfield, Illinois, using the, once he gets into Ohio, what's called the, would be at that time called the Cleveland and Erie Railroad. Today we know it as CSX. And along the way, Lincoln would stop at different towns, and if he had the voice for it, he'd give a little bit of a speech. And by the time he got to Conneaut, having traveled all the way from Illinois, he was pretty well hoarse. So he came out on the platform, and his electorate cheered him on, and he just said, I'm sorry, my voice is raw after all this talking. And there's a great scene that's reported in the newspaper, the Conneaut Reporter, that as the train is chugging off, Gilman Appleby's brother, Calvin, runs up to the train, runs up to Lincoln, and he hollers at him, "Don't give up the ship!" And Lincoln is reported to say, "With your help, I never shall." So, of course, we know the rest of it. Following Lincoln's election, the South seceded, and we descended into the American Civil War, a war which killed more American lives than any other war that we fought. And it's important to note that the people who fought the American Civil War fought for a multitude of reasons. Many fought to preserve the union between the North and the South. As Andrew Jackson once proposed to the secessionist senator from South Carolina, John Calhoun, "The union, may it be preserved forever." But despite all that, despite whatever their rationale was, at the end of the American Civil War, slavery was effectively ended within the United States, at least for one part of the population. And to that we have a legacy to thank, not only of the slaves themselves who really built the United States on their labor, but those who also helped free them from slavery. So I wish to thank everyone for coming out and trouncing through the cemetery with me today. At this time, I would like to open up discussion for any questions.
Sweet chariot, come in for carry me home. I looked over Jordan, what did I see?